want to talk about as opposed to, you know, what you think they want to talk about. So, so let's go ahead then. Okay, right. Let's bang on. Let's just see, does this work? Oh yeah, chat enables. Okay. Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to begin by publishing a series of tweet-length statements, which I'll then just expand in greater detail. And these are random enough in terms of that I wrote them down as they occurred to me rather than the fact that they were being organized. They are the sort of standard thing when people ask me about what are the differences between living in Spain and Ireland. The first thing I always say is that that Ireland, as I remember from the first line of Brendan Walsh's economics textbook, is Ireland is a small open economy. And I tend to contrast that with Spain as being a large closed economy. Now, obviously, in the age of globalization, to say that it's closed is an exaggeration. But there is a lot about it that's closed in that it's sufficiently large that in Ireland, because it's small, you're forced almost immediately to go abroad. It's very hard to sustain anything just on Ireland. Whereas Spain is large enough with a market of 46 million people. So a lot of businesses never in their business plan certainly talk about going outside Spain. If it happens, very much so. But it's also closed in the sense of just people tend to go on holidays here. People's their family and friends tend to be from Spain or other parts of Spain. In fact, they almost contrasted like the way we would perhaps talk about the States and things like that. They would talk about other parts of Spain. So it's in that sense, it's very much a closed kind of economy. So it'd be quite unusual. Someone would ask you in Ireland, like, where are you from? Or where have you been to? Generally, you would have a comment or you might have been there or something where that doesn't really happen in Spain. So that's the first thing. The second thing is a bit of a caveat to say, which is that, of course, I live in Madrid. And even though I travel to other parts of Spain and also other parts of Europe, I still am based in Madrid. So it's a bit like people talking about Ireland from a base in Dublin. So you always have to be careful about that. Which is to say that my experiences very often, particularly with positive things, I had a very positive things to say about, say, health infrastructure and transport infrastructure in Madrid, and then people correct me and say that it's not like that all over Spain. So so let me just kind of make that comment. Now in terms of how the debate might go, I had a look at some of the other speakers who've talked, and I tend to talk more about qualitative trends rather than quantitative trends. In other words, you know, getting into discussions about, contracts for difference and all these kind of things. I tend to look at trends in terms of qualitative. You know, in other words, like because they tend to be more longer lasting and more sustaining. In other words, like people's attitude towards property, for instance, and I would tend to talk about that. Rather than going straight into the figures and saying, you know, X number of houses are empty, X numbers were sold, and that kind of thing. So that's generally when anyone asks me a question, series of numbers.
In terms of property ownership, I work and most, like that. Just curious as to the similarities or differences.
But also, I work quite closely with people trying to start up a business.
I know in general,
so that is kind of my area of expertise as such. So I know quite well in terms of the businesses that are existing in Spain and successful and kind of why they're successful, what they're good at and what they're not. And also working with young entrepreneurs, particularly when they're trying to set businesses up. So I would have a good idea about why it's difficult to set up a business and why it's not difficult to set up a business and, you know, regulations and these kind of things. So, for instance, in Spain, it is very difficult still to set up a business and the competitive situation is not all that clear. The other thing I'm going to put in is the idea of Spain as a centralized and versus a decentralized country. You're talking about, in Ireland, for instance, is a very centralized country. The main departments of civil service would exert an awful lot of control. Whereas in Spain, I mean, three of the what are called three of the naciones, or the nations, exist almost, apart from defense, really exist almost independently. Some of them even collect their own taxes and then send them to the centralized state. So as people say, they have everything except a team in the Olympic Games. Whereas, and even at regional level, there's quite an amount of autonomy. That has come from the constitution, the post, what's called the democratic constitution. But they tended, there was a kind of an agreement that the regions would be given quite a lot of autonomy. That's both very good and very bad. Obviously, there's a big issue now, because there was elections recently and new administrations have gone in and they are complaining about mismanagement and these kind of issues. My experience of dealing both with the centralized government and with the regional administration is that what you meet in the center, certainly in terms of the civil service, are really excellent. You know, they have that almost a tradition of public service, and they, you know, educate themselves and take their jobs seriously and stuff like that. Whereas the people you meet in the more regional administrations, they're not quite at that caliber. Wanted to make the distinction between, you know, when people talk about politicians or when people talk about, you know, civil servants, or which are called funcionarios in this country. So I just wanted to make the distinction that at centralized level, you really do meet some really good people, and they are doing their best under very different circumstances. Whereas when you go down a notch to the regional administrations, I don't think that the caliber is quite as good. The next thing then is something I referred to earlier, but put it in anyway, which is the notion of Spain, just as a big enough country, it isn't as, and I guess as, you know, they had between the 1930s and the 1970s, they were very much closed in. It's still not very open to the world. That's changing, particularly the younger generation and the, you know, using the internet and things like that. But in general, they don't take a very big interest. I know my own situation. My wife can't understand why I have any interest in what's going on in the United States. Like, why I would sit and watch the night Barack Obama was elected. She's like, why? We don't live in America. Why would you be interested in that? And even, you know, what's going on in the Middle East with Israel and, you know, North Africa, these kind of issues, there generally wouldn't be an awful lot of interest in that. Unless people are affected, they tend not to take very much of an interest in it. And then the other issue is that the levels of English spoken are quite low. French was generally the first language that was learned. But even then, there is a lot of talk in Spain about the education system and the so-called PISA report, which found that Spain didn't get very good ratings. And there is a big, you know, they're quite embarrassed about their politicians not being able to speak English. There's lots of the current Prime Minister, Zapatero, is, you know, famously a not an English speaker, and there's lots of pictures of him at conferences, international conferences, and he's kind of sitting there on his own because he doesn't have the language to communicate. That's obviously changing, but the levels of people that the levels of English spoken are quite low. I think 10% was the figure I have roughly in my head, which, if you think about it, is really low. Now let me talk about this indignados movement, which is, I wanted to make the point, I just wrote an article for Entrepreneur Country about this, that I consider that it's quite a genuine movement. There is a debate as to whether it is, you know, just whingers, basically. There's possibly nicer terms for it, but either whingers who aren't against the corruption. What they are, the suggestion is that they're not against what the politicians are doing, but that it doesn't benefit them. In other words, it's not like a moral issue. I think that's a bit unfair. I see a lot of people, and I've gone down to some of the protests to hear what's being said and the posters that are up. And I think there's a lot of people down there who, are in a reasonably good position and would stand to benefit from a kind of a no change type situation. But they're still in there and they realize that, issues such as like the growth of Asia and the decline of the Western world and these kind of things that, actually, to use the phrase from the Prince, that for things to stay the same, they have to change. So in that respect, I think that I think it deserves a chance. You know, I think it's unfair to kind of criticize them. You know, let's sort of see what happens and see if they have. They're already having quite a big effect on the issues. Well, maybe not big, but certainly on the street, they're managing to organize and to stop people from being evicted from mortgages. And even the politicians, in a small enough way, are being less confrontational, which was a central kind of complaint. In other words, it was a sort of like the Tweedledum and Tweedledee. In other words, rather than addressing the issues, they tended to just say, well, you know, the other crowd are worse, or the other crowd have no proposals or something like that. Whereas, you know, the latest political speeches tend to be not to refer directly to the opposition and tend to be more policy led. So in that sense, things are changing. But I think very early on, and there's a small number of what I would call unsavory incidents where people associated with the movement, maybe not, you know, centrally involved in the movement, you know, have, you know, how would I say, introduced a kind of an ominous tone to the situation, a more confrontational tone, rather than which wasn't the original plan. But I think it's something that you know, deserves a chance. I'm we'll follow and see sort of how it you know, where it leads from there. The next thing then, next point I was going to make was the idea of health education and public services are still quite good, particularly in Madrid. I mean, I, you know, would never pay anything for health, really, even though we have private health insurance, just that the public services are so good. Now, that isn't for everywhere and it isn't in every part, but, you know, things like education, still the universities, okay, they mightn't be world ranking, but in terms of, they're not that expensive and they're quite accessible. And in transport, you know, obviously anyone who's been to Madrid knows how good the metro is, but that's equally true in other parts, you know, in Bilbao and Barcelona. So it is something I end up talking a lot with people back in Ireland about, how we have let these things slip, you know, in a small space of time. And you know, maybe that's something we might talk about. But I think that there is very much, even among the more right-wing elements, very much there would be no question of letting these services not be at certain levels. I'll continue then. The other thing I was going to say is the culture of engineering, which, you know, is again something in Ireland we might be losing. Here, engineers tend to be spoken of in the same breath as doctors and lawyers, which is a good thing, and that's maybe the reason why there's so many. I think 8 out of the top 10 construction companies in the world are Spanish, or at least, or, you know, have relationships, you know, or in partnerships with other large companies. But so there's, you know, fantastic projects, tunnels that go through for traffic and that kind of thing. So there is a culture of engineering. Even at my own level of software engineering, I see really good work being done. And it perhaps doesn't get the credit that it should do in terms of like big companies forming from it, but certainly in the quality of the work I experience is of a really high standard. The kind of place. But that's so what you're talking about in effect is a huge change from where nobody owned their homes or very few people to where almost everyone. Now, obviously, in many cases, the bank owns the house rather than the person, but it is interesting how that change has happened in a generation, and there is a very strong attachment to home ownership. The next point is number 11, which is possibly one of the most important of the points I'll make today, which is Spain's economic model and the lack thereof. One of the striking things about the change from so-called right-wing to so-called left-wing is how there is unanimity in the economic model. I mean, you could actually argue the same exists in Ireland and really possibly in the UK, certainly during Tony Blair's time, that the economic model was mass tourism from Northern Europe and private home ownership, meaning construction, meaning, you know, interior furniture and these kind of things. But it's quite striking that no matter what happened, no matter who came in, whether you had like a dictatorship and technocrats, or you had so-called, you know, post or, you know, democracy, so-called socialist worker party, they didn't really change very much in terms of what the actual model was of how of you know, how the, what the country did to generate income and how it brought prosperity. That is at an absolute, there's more talk than ever now about how that needs to change and, you know, how Spain needs to become. I haven't heard the phrase knowledge economy, but that's the kind of thing they're talking about and how they need to, for instance, they still export lots of raw materials to other countries. The case that's given a lot is olive oil, that instead of that, a lot of Spain's olives get exported to Italy and then Italy bottle them and package them and sell them. So they lose a lot of the value add. So in a sense of, there is a huge talk about the need that Spain needs to come up with, you know, an economic model other than the one that, that has been there essentially since the 50s. Another interesting point, and actually it used to be more true than it is now, but the large companies which have been privatized, Telefonica is the phone company, I guess sort of like Aircom, and Repsol would be the oil company, like BP would be an equivalent. Even though they're private quoted companies, they in reality are a lot like semi-states. In other words, the government's influence on them is quite substantial. You know, the boards tend to change after elections, you know, and these kind of things. Whereas I don't think that's true to the same extent in Ireland. Certainly it might be true, but I don't think it's true to anything near like the extent it is in Spain. And then they also have a quote about, you know, you don't know where the energy ministry ends and where Repsol begins, which is to say, certainly would get, you know, it would be, you know, have to be, I guess, be careful what I'm saying, but there would be certainly would be a very close relationship. The senior people would know each other very well and would be in communication. And there's a sort of a symbiotic relationship, you know, about what's good for General Motors is good for America. You know, there would be a feeling that what's good for Repsol is good for Spain. And I don't think I've really ever heard that about an Irish firm. I've never heard anyone say, you know, what's good for the ESB is good for Ireland. And similarly, just I want to talk about this phenomenon known as crowding out, which is, you know, the idea of crowding out of private investment. And this to me is the biggest problem in Spain. I think Spain has a lot of resources, a lot of capable individuals, but it tends, you know, firms don't tend to be created because of fear of government intervention. You don't know what the government is likely to do at any stage. For instance, they got very involved in the alternative energy sector and solar power and those kind of things. And that drew in a lot of private investment. But then they changed the law and there was a lot of complaint about how unfair that was. I guess the main point I want to make is that there's very few businesses, internet businesses would be possibly the only ones that you just, you know, set up and you don't have to deal with very much interference from the government. In almost every other sphere, the government are an actor and a considerable player, and you have to, you know, you have to manage your relationships with them. You know, lest I've said too many bad things about Spain, medium term, I'm very hopeful. I mean, Spain is, you know, has a lot going for it. I mean, you're not talking, you know, when I criticize it, I mean, there's countries in the world who are in much worse position. It, you know, it is, there's no question that it's not a stable democracy. It has resources. It has education. It has lots of very good things about it. I often think it's a bit like pre-Celtic Tiger Ireland, which admittedly is something I've read about rather than something that I really experienced. But issues like getting women into the workplace, you know, raising the levels of English speaking and just getting people in general more interested in what's happening outside the world. I think all these issues will come now. I think there is a genuine turning point happening. And I think Spain economically will be much more productive, you know, because when those things happen. It's often talked that the Celtic Tiger is, I mean, a huge issue with just getting family-friendly workplaces and that got a lot of more educated women into the workplace. And that's certainly something that, from a diversity point of view, I'd love to see. In terms of links with Ireland, I've heard the figure of that 50,000 Spaniards come to Ireland every summer to learn English, which seems to be a tremendously high figure, but I guess it's possible if you break it down. So there is huge links with Ireland, and a lot of meetings I would have would begin with somebody telling me about a summer they spent in Kells or something like that, which is, and they you know, very much in, for many people, it's their first real time away from home and, you know, they feel free and that kind of thing. So there is an awful lot of affection for Ireland and interest in Ireland. And in that sense, it's for an Irish person in Spain, it's quite a good place to come and do business. So that's sort of my 15 points to sort of kick the thing off and see, try and encourage debate. So does anyone have any kind of any questions on any of those or would anyone like me to go into any more detail about what I've said?
Maybe you could elaborate a little bit more on the solar side of things, Joe, because I know it's a, you know, alternative energy and what's happening in Ireland in terms of wind energy and what we're trying to do there. Obviously, in Spain, you've got the climate for solar, and I know there's some huge projects going on, but they're also getting involved with wind. Is that happening too?
Yeah, I mean, Spain is, it's a sort of an alternative energy mecca. In that not only is it has it lots of sun, obviously, but it does have a lot of wind as well, and it's quite high. Spain is quite high country. I mean, here in Madrid, I'm at 800 meters, but other parts of it, like it's almost like a plateau. So that's, you know, the idea of wind, both wind generation and also solar, are very strong possibilities. A number of Spanish companies promoted by the government, Iberdrola Renovables would be one of them, Iberdrola Renewables. And then there's Gamesa, who make the turbines. And there's a lot of Spanish companies that have made big investments and are actually, you know, have gone out all over the world and are leading, you know, setting up these wind farms or these solar farms. So they would, you know, Spain would, I think even Barack Obama mentioned it once in a speech, which was, you know, got a lot of news here. But there is, Spain doesn't have any oil. It has, and it doesn't, as far as I'm, I don't think it has any coal. I know it has a small bit of uranium, but not very much in terms of its nuclear industry. But I still think, because it's not the right kind of uranium that they have to bring in a lot of the stuff they use. But, I mean, Denmark are often talked of as being the, you know, one of the highest countries for renewables. But Spain, I think at some stage they were, I've seen figures that they were generating 25% of their national grid electricity based on renewables, which is pretty impressive. Well, some of the problems is that they had this thing called the feed-in tariff, whereby they guaranteed that the government would buy any electricity that was generated through a renewable source at a certain rate. And they slightly reneged on that. And I mean, this is sort of a fluid situation, you know, even as we speak. But that has caused, because once, I mean, obviously, once you had a guaranteed price for something, it was a very easy business. As long as you had the capital to set up, a lot of people jumped in. But there just tended to be excess capacity, and there tended to be a lot of poorly implemented schemes. So, you know, they were sort of saying like a third of them work effectively, a third of them are a bit dodgy, and a third of them are, you know, not working at all. So there was changing the feed-in tariff was a kind of a way of trying to sort, you know, almost get some of the people to get out of the business who hadn't done very good implementations or you know, maybe get that capital allocated in another area. But I think there's definitely anyone interested in renewables, Spain is a very good story. You know, some very good stuff has been done here.
I don't know if you followed Tom Raftery. Raftery. He's very active in the area. I follow his tweets. He's big in the renewables and sustainability and so on. Ian is just.
Yeah, no, he came up to Madrid and gave a talk for the Spanish Irish Business Network.
Okay.
And he was in UCC the same time I was, so I know him from that. But
all right.
Yeah, no, he would be. Well, the big thing Tom talks about are what's called smart grids, which is, you know, this notion of,
yeah.
And I mean, that would be a huge innovation. What Tom likes to talk about is the idea that, like, that the telephone, is still largely, that when Edison set up the telephone, so many things have changed about the way the telephone system is done, but the electricity grid is largely, the design of it is largely unchanged since back in the days of you know, Edison and these kind of power companies. So, you know, the notion that really every house should have a smart grid and that you should be allowed to interact. And if that was there, it would help a lot with this crazy situation where a lot of people, a lot of companies generate electricity that they have to spill because they can't get anyone to take it. You know, in other words, during the night when the turbines are spinning, generating electricity, they can't get anyone who wants that electricity. So that is a very, just because of the way the grid is designed, etc. So that, I mean, that's a crazy situation.
I mean, Ardna Crusha was years ahead of its time, wasn't it? You know.
Well, yeah.
You know, in Ireland, I mean. Siemens, yeah. Ian is just asking a question there in the chat box. Any work in wave energy as you have Atlantic coastline like Ireland?
Not as much because of wind and, I mean, there's almost excess capacity with wind and solar. That, you know, all of the energy, all of the investments, all of the know-how goes into looking at those and making those better. As I understand it, wave is still a longer way away. And, in other words, I think the people look at kind of getting near commercial solutions more commercial rather than, you know, starting with original technologies. I certainly have never come across any kind of wave technology. I know that, I mean, the Mediterranean is, you know, it's famously a quiet sea. It's almost a sea without waves. And, you know, Portugal is kind of in the way then in terms of the Atlantic. And then up the north coast, Galicia tends to be, it's a difficult, because it's a very jagged coastline, it tends to be kind of a difficult place to set anything up. You know, you kind of need certain kinds of harbors and certain, you want it to be exposed, but not too exposed. But certainly I've never heard anyone talk about wave energy. The big ones people would talk about would be wind and solar.
So is Spain a net exporter of energy then, in that case, Joe?
Tom Raftery now would be the guy you need to talk about this, but I don't think so.
Yeah.
I know that they have, the grid is a privatized utility, so in a sense you would expect so. But I have never really heard about it. I know that the French, which would be like the obvious first place that they would go, because they have energy security in terms of nuclear. They don't have, again, I'm not really aware of that, and it would probably be, if it was going on, it would probably be something that would be widely known. But I still think they're trying to, you know, I mean, it's an engineering challenge in terms of transmission lines and these kind of issues.
Sure.
You would expect it should be something that could happen, but then you go back to the big question about, you know, why isn't energy more cheaper? In other words, like if you're getting it from wind and solar, so you've no raw materials, why isn't it cheaper? Because you have to obviously pay for coal and oil.
It's all relative to the price of the barrel, though, Joe. It's all relative to the price of the barrel. If the barrel is $300 a barrel, then wind and solar become very,
But I mean, go back to the issue about raw material and input costs. You know, I mean, you have zero input costs effectively for solar and wind. Whereas you have considerable input costs for coal and for oil. So, you know, how come the output costs or the price at which you're the megawatts or the gigawatts are charged for is then the same? And I know people are saying they're recovering their investments, et cetera, et cetera. But, it's an interesting question. I've seen debated a few times about how if the input costs are down, surely the price of energy should come down over time. So, I don't know, maybe we need to get Tom on here to ask him about that.
Yeah, Tom has been on before, and we've had Kieran Cuff when he was Minister for State as well, and, it was a big discussion about that in terms of, you know, not just like, for example, food security and what else Ireland's got going for us, and the connector through to the UK, and obviously we'll be buying nuclear power at some stage. You know, I mean, that's another trade-off for Ireland. We don't have nuclear, and should we have nuclear? You know, and obviously I'm not a big fan, but, you know, based on Fukushima, it's a big problem.
I was speaking to a friend of mine the other day, and he was kind of making the joke that, you know, Ireland are, you know, we're fine for like poetry and music and these kind of things, but like you said, we just don't have the kind of culture for, you know, for nuclear. I mean, and he's an engineer and he works in one of the big engineering companies. And he said, like he said, he said, I don't know exactly why it is, he said, but I'd be really worried about a nuclear power plant being run by Irish people. He said, we can make silicon chips really well. He said, we can, you know, make printers. We can do all that kind of stuff. But he said, just about nuclear. He said, we just shouldn't go there, you know. And I think he was, I mean,
yeah, but I mean, the ESB International are world renowned for their engineering and services. You know,
over here they had quite a team over here, particularly in Bilbao. They have a good presence. You do kind of come across them, and they are very, very highly regarded for what they do. I think actually they're not as, they still have some guys here on the ground, but I think there was one particular project that they were mostly here for that has got to the end, and they haven't, so a lot of them went back. But no, I think ESB are mm-hmm. you know, genuine, the ESB International are, you know.
Yeah. Ian's just asking there, in terms of public reaction, the financials.
Yeah.
What is the view of the populace to massive government debt?
There is. I mean, well, I think it's not as, first of all, these kind of issues wouldn't be discussed in the way they are in Ireland, you know. I mean, it just wouldn't be sort of seen as, you know, you would get, it would be in the financial press, you know, wouldn't be a kind of a mainstream issue that would be, the news would kind of be talking about very much. So there wouldn't be awareness of, say, you know, if the 10-year goes up by a certain number of basis points, then therefore the country has to pay more interest, therefore it has a wider deficit, you know, therefore there's less money to spend on services. I mean, there wouldn't be that kind of link being made. I think there is certain frustration in terms of, and there isn't either this thing about, like, you know, what's happened in Greece and Portugal. The issue is more, you know, badly, in general, politicians, just this financial mismanagement is yet another example of that the politicians serve their own interests rather than the interests of the people. In other words, that they will make decisions based on their interests rather than what is in the medium-term interests of Spain. The other issue in terms of, actually, their debts in terms of debt-to-GDP ratio isn't that high. So they talk about that all the time. But, you know, Italy will be, it's much higher, say, in Italy. And but there just isn't that much interest in what happens in other countries. Even in Portugal, I remember opening the main newspaper, and the elections in Portugal were covered on page 4. You know, you would have thought that, like, you know, the elections in Portugal would be covered, like, would be front page in central news. But they weren't really, you know. And there would be, you know, it wouldn't be really a big issue. It would be an issue as part of a general complaint about that we don't have good politicians, we don't have, you know, that there's kind of austerity will come. But yeah, I would be more aware, oddly, of the situation in Ireland than I would be in Spain. In Spain, it's just not really talked about outside of the financial community.
Cool, Joe. Cool. We're on 40 minutes, Joe. Unless Ian has any other questions.
Sure, yeah. Loud and clear. No. I mean, I touched on that. I think it was point number 8. There's a very, very high levels of Spain ownership and of ownership of people's house. One second. Turn your audio off. Okay. I mean, I've heard rates of over 90% of houses are, I mean, obviously the house is most cases owned by the bank rather than the person who lives in it. But people's attitude would be to buy rather than rent, you know, rent is not, is, and that's changed very much in a generation, because like the 40s, 50s and these kind of time, most people rented. Spain has kind of gone from a nation of renters and small business owners to like a nation of civil servants and, property owners, you know, and that's changed in a small enough period of time. And, you know, there's a lot of talk about we were better off the other way. That's, you would hear people saying that. But, certainly there would be, very much a culture of property ownership that, as you say, there wouldn't be in Germany and Italy and in France. And that's very much encouraged because their economic policy is based on the idea of private housing ownership and it's kind of the motor of their economy. So it would be, there'd be wide agreement across the, and no politician would ever say that like that. I mean, I always used to say, you know, I mean, economics would tell you that a good is priced a certain way and that price stability is what you always want. So in that sense, rising house prices actually aren't good in according to economic theories. I mean, you'd ask someone, are they in favor of an increase in the price of a pint? And then everyone would say, no, absolutely not. And you say, well, it's the same issue with the house, you know, that you shouldn't want the prices increase on housing either. But no politician would ever come out and say that. You know, that wouldn't be.
But Spain has the highest amount of lawyers, I believe, per capita in the world. And of course,
a lot of them would be, you know, they wouldn't necessarily be practicing. You know, law would be seen in some way like literature. You know, people would study the law because they're kind of interested in it. And yeah, it's the old thing about you're not comparing like with like, but you do meet a lot of people would do law and then not practice and mm-hmm. they would still be admitted to the Colegio de Abogados and the college of lawyers. But
Ian has a new question there, Joe.
Sure, it has. I'm just going to say it has a huge amount of doctors as well, many of whom don't practice either.
Will you send them over here, please?
Well, some of them are going. It's quite amazing. You see an awful lot of ads over here looking for doctors and nurses to go to Ireland. I often try and square that with what I'm hearing. There's an awful lot of medical schools, and they're all churning out doctors. You know, doctors again wouldn't be seen as an elitist kind of a thing in the way it would be in Ireland. Like a kind of, oh, he's a doctor. You know, a lot of people would be, doctor is just, you know, he's a doctor, he's an engineer, he's seen as a professional in the same way. And they certainly wouldn't be seen as people who earn lots of money. They wouldn't have that association at all like they do back home. Now, Ian Murphy, has the property market suffered recently? Have Spaniards invested in an asset class or is it just domestic ownership? That's a kind of an interesting question. The property market, they're greatly, greatly overvalued. I mean, if you talk about the multiples, you know, the famous historic, like 14 times annual rent is what a price should be, what a house should be worth. And then, or what a bank should lend is, you know, two and a half to three times the principal earner's salary. You know, those are like the historic multiples that we would all have grown up on. I mean, those are completely out of whack here in Spain. The average salary is quite low. I mean, you're talking about, I think it's like 18,000 euro or something like that. And I've seen, according to the tax authorities, only 4.6% of tax declarers earn more than 60,000 euro. You know, which actually, you know, someone who earns 60,000 euro would be seen as like a lot of money. You'd be seen as like a really, really good sort of salary. So then you try and marry that. You try and see that to the price that's being paid for houses, and then you start to see that immediately that it's completely crazy. And there would be no sophistication in terms of asset classes or anything like that. It would be like, what's a month's rent? And what's a month's mortgage? And that would be the comparison that would be made. I mean, there would be very little sort of talk about if interest rates go up or these kind of things. And also there's very few, most of them are tracker mortgages as well, meaning, variable. So when the Euribor changes, then the bank can change that rate as well. There'll be very few fixed. So it's actually, but there's actually a crash waiting to happen. The banks are doing everything they can. Some bank branches have actually turned into auctioneers. You know, where there used to be a branch of a bank, they have turned that into an auctioneering firm. In other words, if the bank is now selling the properties that they have either, you know, that people have signed, bought off the plans, and then basically not gone through with, or they've been repossessed, or something like that. So that would be, again, they're doing everything so that the price doesn't
change. What are the bankruptcy laws like, Joe?
Yeah, that's a really interesting thing happened this week. I tweeted it, you may have seen that. It was in Spanish, but for the first time ever, one of the banks has introduced a product, Bank Inter, which happens to be my bank, but they have introduced a product whereby if you take out a mortgage, it's a non-recourse product. In other words, that the only thing you're liable for should you default on the mortgage is the house itself. In other words, they can't come after any other assets you might have. And so that is a really interesting thing. Some people would say that it's come years too late, because right now, you know, your debt follows you. Basically, if you have to give back a house, it's whatever the difference between, you know, your negative equity follows you onto everything. So that's a really interesting development in the market. And, you know, I think it's as I say, it's come too late. But in most cases, the terms under which people have taken out their mortgages, if they hand back the keys, they're liable for the debt.
Yes, there's some debt cancellation going on here at the moment as well. And I'm just hearing a case there that the solicitor has become not so much an auctioneer, but more an estate agent. And the only way the solicitor can make money, and they do a settlement with the bank, and the debt cancellation is, you know, on 600 grand was 200,000.
Yeah.
And they were able to walk away. But they need to do that because people just can't sell their houses.
No, absolutely. I mean, you know, it's, as David McWilliams talks about, it's time for innovative solutions. You know, I mean, if it's someone has a target, no matter how bad, that they think is achievable and doable, you know, they will generally try and go after that. You know, they'll accept that. But if it's like 600,000, so it's like everything you earn for the rest of your life just to be back at zero, I mean, people are just going to emigrate, you know, change their name, default, do whatever.
Well,
you know,
people are moving to the UK because they can go bankrupt over there. And I think
I mean, why, you know, again, that should be something that the government should act on immediately. You know, I mean, this is the type
Absolutely.
Of thing that people complain about the politicians, you know, that they don't bring in laws. They bring in very, you know, I mean, if you think about it, they don't bring in laws that affect people's lives directly. They bring in just very kind of laws that politicians feel are important, but not ones that affect people's lives directly. I mean, bankruptcy in terms of like company foundation would be another thing I would, you know, work with directly, whereby set up a company, you can be liable for the debts of the company if the company goes wallop. You know, you don't have limited liability, and you're liable for all sorts of, and that would follow you forever. In other words, like that would be coded onto your bank account, and if you ever put money into your bank account, it would be taken straight out. You know, and so you have those kind of things.
What about corporation tax, Joe?
Well, yeah, I mean, corporate, I think it's the highest in Europe. I think it's, you know, near 35% or something like that. But that would be, the attitude towards corporation tax would be, because the government works so closely with the large companies anyway, that it would almost be like a, you know, like almost like a wrench, you know. In other words, they would give them, you know, as a sort of an unofficial understanding for not pursuing them on competition, you know, giving them kind of concessions and, you know, maybe like say 10 years or something like that, compete free as a kind of a concession for that would be an understanding that the corporation, you know, that's what the government gets back for that, you know. So it would almost
return,
like a public private partnership, you know, if you understand that kind of thing. So there isn't much of an issue about corporation tax. The other interesting issue is the one of Spanish companies buying things overseas and the treatment of goodwill, which they can use that as an offset. That has been a very favorable tax treatment that a lot of Spanish companies have availed of. So in other words, they can buy stuff overseas, and the treatment of it can be such that it doesn't cost them as much as the headline figure. But in general, there would be very, very little sympathy for corporation tax, and it would be quite high. I don't actually know I must look up the figure. But there is a small bit. I occasionally get inquiries about locating in Ireland, and the laws are quite similar, are quite favourable in terms of if you wanted to do it. So you could incorporate in Ireland and maybe have, like, as long as you have some operation there. I think you don't even actually have to have any operation there, but I think it would be better, preferable if you did. But you could start to do that, but that would bring...
Just get a phone number and the IFSC.
Yeah, but I think that the feeling of would be that would bring the authorities down on top of you in other ways, if you know what I mean. Like, if you pull the stunt like that, it's legally possible, but the government would be very sensitive about that kind of thing, because, again, they regard their corporation tax as a kind of, like, the part of there's ways of doing this. There's ways of running an economy. One thing would be to have competition and low tax, and the other way would be to have lack of competition and high tax. And that seems to be the way that they've gone.
Cool. Okay, Joe. Unless Ian has any more questions, we'll wrap it there.